Moving forward. Bien, ben merci d'être ici.
Thank you for your presence here. You may all remember yesterday there were all sorts of certainties or things that could be taken for granted. For instance, peri-urban is not something in parentheses. It is here to stay. It has taken root. Everybody agreed on that. Number two, it seems to me that many of the statements point to another certainty. There's a very typically French type of peri-urbanity, and that peri-urban sphere is much more nuanced and diversified than some of the stereotypes that are often bandied about, as was pointed out with some humor yesterday morning. So some studies have criticized beliefs that are unfair to peri-urbanites and peri-urban policies and life in peri-urbia. Now, is this to say there's good and bad research on peri-urbia? Is there a stigmatizing research, an objective research, free or standardizing research? Is there such a thing as a good and bad peri-urbia? Is there a peri-urbia that deserves to live and prosper? And is there a peri-urbia that needs to be corrected, redressed, or removed? And you may remember there's we had the environmental roundtables here in Paris, Grenelle de l'environnement, and other bills. Now, at a time of crisis, multifarious crisis, economic crisis, energy crisis, political crisis, and we can see that there's even an urban crisis. You can see we ask whether peri-urbia can survive the energy and the climate crisis, as well as the economic crisis. Rather than pointing fingers, you might think, I mean, at least some believe that peri-urbia could be, as it were, the scapegoat for all these evils, or it could be seen by others as an expiatory victim. In any event, French society has had to make choices over the past 10 years, and at the time of crisis, you might ask what room will be given, what position will be given peri-urbia by French society, what is the future of a French-style peri-urbia. So this is a very Franco-French debate, which we translate into English. But of course, if you're not familiar with the French landscape, this might be difficult for you to understand. Let me introduce the five speakers, like the five the five protagonists of a series. So there will be our five characters, our five desperate peri-urban researchers. Here, Eric has the unfortunate privilege of having been right too early. His idea has not yet, or his ideas have not, the time has not yet come for his ideas. And Jean-Pierre is a visionary. Yves Crozet on the white chair is an economist, I believe, and he was at the head of the Observatory of Transportation, and he spoke with Olivier Klein yesterday. He's one of these young scientists. Well, you're very young, but Olivier is even younger than you. So Yves Crozet did some very clever teasing yesterday, some sort of a coming attraction about this threshold beyond and below which you would distribute or you would separate out the winners and the losers of peri-urbia. Jacques Lévy is sitting on the blue chair. apart from the others, and he found an equation, peri-urban vote equals national front vote, and of course the media seized upon this in 2007, indeed in 2002, so he's the great stigmatizer, and Eric Charme, sitting next to me, blames him, criticizes him for this, and he wrote some writings, and I have the quotes right here. I have the references right here, so they cannot deny anything. But Eric Charme, nonetheless, is the inventor of a formula that was very successful, taken up by all the media. Periurbia as a place of clubization, that is, how clubs are formed, or social clubs are formed. We're trying to, an essay on clubization of urban life, the scattered city, that's what it's called. And so Eric Charme is the specialist, the expert. Hélène Thénault is the only woman here. And so at least we have some women on the panel, and she is the woman of energy transition. Did she know where she was setting food by standing in for Alain Grandjean? He chickened out. Well, there may be a surprise for her. But Jean-Michel Roux, you are the visionary, you are the elder of us all, the elder statesman. Now, this landscape is a post-war landscape. It accounts for 50% of urban building of the past 40 years. And it is, you said, an undisciplined and unregulated response to great building complexes that are expensive to renovate. So is this to say that Periurbia has taken on all the blame for the problems of specific areas, that is like La Défense, where you have a concentration of towers? Is Periurbia the scapegoat for all urban construction? No, there's no economic balance to be found in the urban landscape, or at least if any equations are found, any correlations are found, they are all subject to caution and can be disproved very easily. But nonetheless, we could shed some light on aspects of urban economy and property, and the property industry, the property economy. It has been said that detached or semi-detached units have been developing, taking advantage of the lower prices of land and property. But land is much more expensive for detached houses than for office, or rather apartment buildings. So it's not really a matter of the price of land. So maybe you can see some economic trends governing, as it were, the governing periurbia, but there are some cliches that should be set aside. We have periurbia everywhere, but why do we mention periurbia all the time? Well, even the UN realized that there is no such thing as a, well, there's a continuum, and it doesn't happen everywhere at the same time, and it depends on the social, economic, and political development of a country. But there's a trend, there's a continuum between urban centers and what is referred to as periurbia. And you may remember in France in the 1970s, we already found this continuum and the way in which statisticians had divided up the country was not in line with reality. There were migration flows that were going in opposite directions as to what was believed. 97% of the population by the 1970s was in the service industry and manufacturing, with only 3% in agriculture. So this the data had changed considerably, and the housing had changed as well. But of course, it means that some area, such as, well, precisely land for farming, is so-called free space, should be regulated in such a way as to preserve it. Now, after World War II, the government took over, well, the French territory and decided to modernize the territory and railroading this modernization. And of course, some countries have envied this urbanization, but now we can see the weaknesses building complexes, and we have on the one hand destroyed the rural landscape, and we have built these peri-urban concrete complexes that are really quite an eyesore and difficult to maintain and everything there. So there's been this sort of sprawling, although sprawling is not the right terms, but this sort of disseminated building and disseminated development has occurred in France after World War II with all sorts of consequences. Number one, the initial urbanization that started between 1958 and 1975, to be very precise, that was the initial plan was turned down, and I know about this because I did my research. There has been a trend to people started buying cars. That was completely unexpected. I mean, the planning department had no clue. And the third thing is that there was a third factor. There were mortgage lending and consumer lending started in the 1960s, and that again took the administration unprepared. And so now, of course, these disseminated semi or detached housing developments have been stigmatized, and this is something unique to France. You do not see this elsewhere. I mean, there are other countries where suburbia is a perfectly accepted concept, but not in France. So let me get this right. You're saying, you have historical French reasons for the development of peri-urbia in the French landscape, and to your mind, this has not been considered specifically when considering the crisis, the economic and other crises. But Yves Crozet, I mean, do you agree with Jean-Michel Roux? Do you believe that peri-urbia has brought about a long-term phenomenon that's here to stay? And is this to say that in terms of sustainable development, peri-urbia is worse or better than urban centers? So the first question, is it sustainable? Is it long-term? Well, yes, obviously. And peri-urbia must be considered, even if sociologically and economically it is not very relevant as a concept. So I agree with Olivier Klein, and Rolf de Gueye and others have pointed out that tell me where you live, I'll tell you who you are. That's the wrong question. Tell me how much you earn, tell me your background, your education, and then I'll tell you who you are. These questions are much more relevant than the place of residence, because the lifestyles of peri-urbanites are very similar to lifestyles of urbanites. And we there's been some examination of lifestyles, budgets, compared to distances commuted. Of course, people spend more time on transportation, but there are huge standard deviations in both categories. So both in the cities and in periurbia, you have people spending twice as much time on transportation than the average, and others spending half as much time on transportation than the average. So the standard deviation is such that this issue is not really relevant. But for an economic viewpoint, not looking at geography, where is geography relevant? Well, geography is more relevant because, of course, there are clear trends that will last for good reasons. Number one, contrary to beliefs, the price of oil has been dropping steadily. Well, hang on, you'll have to give us an explanation here. Well, in 1973, 1 hour of minimum wage bought you three liters of gasoline, of petrol, as the British would say. Well, the economists have got it wrong. Well, you have to put this in perspective. In 1980, we had 2 oil shocks. Still, 1 hour of minimum wage got you 3 liters. In 1988, 1 hour of minimum wage got you 6 liters of gasoline, and now we stand at about the same. 1 hour of minimum wage gets you 6 liters of gasoline, not to mention diesel fuel. And now that we have cars that can consume 2 or 3 liters for 100 kilometers, that's what the Prime Minister said. Should we believe the Prime Minister? Well, yes, he's the Prime Minister. He should know. So contrary to what the press has been saying, some families have feeling the price pressure of gasoline, but not everybody at all. The second thing, you cannot have a dense city without without its outskirts, without its periphery. The city is a house of cards or a pyramid of sand. When you increase the height, you have to broaden the base because you have more people around, you have financial possibilities, loans and whatnot. Go to the website Citadel, Citadel. You have all the working permits, the building permits that have been registered in France, and you can draw up a map of building permits in France, and you can see explosion of peri-urban building, including in 2000s, even though the price of oil has remained the same. So that's the second huge significant factor. The third factor is people have access to cars. When you see that when you have a job in the centers, it's easy to access your job. But when you live outside in periurbia, say 25 kilometers away from Lyon, and you have to drive to work 5 kilometers east or west, it's exactly the same. There's no difference. Where you work makes no difference to accessibility, especially if you're driving. And of course, in the Beaujolais area, you have the price of land being lower than in the Saône Valley, 5 kilometers away, but that's a rural area. It's like the big trucks. People say that heavy trucks were horrible things, that all freight transportation will be by railroad. And it doesn't work, not just in France. I mean, of course, we have the French National Railroad with its own freighting company, but it still doesn't work. So everywhere heavy trucks or road transportation is being stigmatized, but it doesn't work. Well, so you're not saying that peri-urbanites or peri-urbia should be put back on trains. No, exactly not. Well, you know that truck road transportation is going to grow. It's inevitable, and we have to look at the consequences, just like peri-urbia is going to develop. And there are some cases where there will be challenges because of that, but it's more the challenges, the problems are more to do with the people's incomes. And we conducted stress tests, it's not just banks doing stress tests. We looked at mobility in certain areas, and there are three situations. Either you're vulnerable, because you may not have suffered at all another price shock. B, are you sensitive to that shock? If you have a train running nearby, you're not sensitive. And the third thing is, are you resilient? I mean, if you're sensitive, can you change modes of transportation? Can you go for carpooling or other form of public transport? And we drew up maps in Lyon or Munich, and we found that there is more resilience depending on how far you live from town. So if you have peri-urbanites that are very little, that are not very resilient, but within these non-resilient zones, the degree of resilience depends on income. If you can afford a car, or it makes a difference as to whether you're resilient or not. So, Jacques Lévy, you are the big critic of Périurbia. What do you have to say to these facts? I mean, A, Périurbia is here to stay, and B, where there are challenges, where there are problems, it is a problem for victims. So why are you saying it's because of them that the National Front is progressing? I never said that. Well, how come you never said that? Everybody says you said it. Well, we all saw your maps. I have nothing to do with it. It just so happens that if you look at voting trends, at political trends, there's a close relationship between the way people vote and their position vis-à-vis the city. I mean, the world, the developed world, is urban, and this will apply not just to the developed world, but to the world at large. But within the urban world, within the urban sphere, you have differences. So is this sort of division, this partitioning between the city and Périurbia, is this partition relevant? This may be a moot point, because within Périurbia, you haven't got trends because it's all disseminated. So we could refer to a different urban form, but instead of giving specific characteristics, you can say what it is not compared to what used to exist before. So there was, of course, a chronological development. This also happened more specifically in Western Europe. We've seen this artist's performancing that suburbia is a universal concept. Well, I disagree, because suburbia is a urban gradient more specific to the United States, and which is indeed a continuity of the city. There's very little periurbia in North America because you haven't got the leverage points with the pre-existing rural areas like you had in Western Europe. But in the United States, you move from suburbia to exurbia, and that is what I would call hyperurban as opposed to periurban. That is, urban forms that are even more remote, where access to the city is even more difficult than in periurbia. So I believe, I mean, if you look at the geographical distribution, wherever in the world you have democracy, the nice thing is that when you have democracy, you have electoral behavior, and then you have masses of data, and you can see a connection between the way people vote and where they live, or where they live within the urban framework. Now, it's pretty, you can certainly see you have two significant choices: A, how you vote; B, where you live. And there, in both cases, you see the relationship between the individual and society. You vote politically to say, how do I fit compared to the rest of society? That is, not just me, but the rest of society, the way it sees itself in the future. And where do I live? And here, I will depart from the economist. This is a choice. This is a choice. Where you live is a choice, just like how you vote is a choice, even if it is not a financial decision, although there are financial factors. So space as well as the economy are cross-cutting. You make choices as to where you live and how you vote based on both economic conditions and geographical factors. And there are, there may be all sorts of things, but there's a hard core. I mean, mobility is not identical with where you live, with location, but the where you live may not be the whole picture, may not be the whole story, but it does count. It does count. And I find it rather surprising. And, well, people find this stigmatizing, but the way you vote or the way you live is a societal choice, is a societal choice. I mean, you decide of the kind of society you want. When you vote or where you move someplace, this is in line with your beliefs. If you look at North America at the beginning of the 20th century and later on in Western Europe, that notion of choice has come in, and because of better purchasing power, because people had access to mortgage loans, it was possible for them to buy homes, and so individuals could be the deciders of their destinies, the strategic choices, that is, should you live close to the city, inside the city, outside the city, should I own a home, should I rent a home, does where I live make a difference, the fact that you own a home with a garden, is that the thing that counts regardless of where you live? And of course these choices carry consequences, and people know this. I mean, they do not know everything ahead of time, of course. Experience will show them new developments or new consequences that they will have to adapt to. But if you look at the middle class that can, that is in a position to make choices, and when you make a choice, it means refusing others, that choice was never made at random. And so there's no surprise there that the choice of where you live, the place of residence, I'm not saying there's a causal link, but there's an association. The two things go together, and there's an association between where you live and how you vote. And if you look at the latest presidential elections in the U.S., I don't know if you saw the electoral map of Obama. It's the same thing in 2008 as in 2012. There's a and there is an espace-temps in analysis that shows that the map, you can see that city centers, urban centers have voted for Obama, including in highly Republican states. I mean, the great cities, the four great cities of Texas, city centers have voted for Obama, whereas for Romney, it's a much more disseminated map, where all the other gradients, that is how far you live from the city, everybody else voted for the right, for Romney in suburbia, in etc. And so it's not just in France. In Switzerland, there are votes on all sorts of issues that are what we call propositions in America, and it could be on all sorts of things, the equal rights for Muslims, homosexuals, everybody that seems that is strange or for the Swiss, people who vote for or against these, depending on how close they live to the city center. People in the capital, in Bern or in Geneva, they tend to be in favor of tolerance to the other, that is, to otherness. Whereas hyper-urban or peri-urbia in Switzerland tends to be more conservative and vote against these, against the others, against these sort of these new, these the, against change, in other words, against the others. Jacques Lévy, well, you're saying this is not stigmatizing, but others say, well, look, if you look at a map, there is a correlation between how close you live to the center and how conservative you are. But you say that this observation brings or gives peri-urbanites a rather negative picture. Well, Jacques Lévy's analysis is well documented, and that's what makes it interesting. You cannot really say that when you publish in Le Monde a paper, an article in which you say there is a a vote for the National Front and the extremes. But of course, when you say that the peri-urbanites sent to vote for the extremes, that doesn't convey a very positive image, does it? And so people believe that if you live in peri-urbia, there's something wrong with you. And even without considering the National Front, we had legislation that says that you have to control urban sprawling. Well, urban sprawling is not the same thing as peri-urbanization, but still, there's this belief that you should try and avoid urban sprawling, and we had this in the environmental roundtable in France, saying that peri-urbia is a disease for the sustainable city. And research has shown that all the arguments put against peri-urbia, even against urban sprawling, because peri-urbia seem to be even worse than urban sprawling. But all the arguments that are made to say that peri-urbia is not sustainable, all these arguments are subject to question. They can be challenged. And so there's no reason to say that peri-urbia is any more of a problem than other forms, than other types of urban living, or indeed any other types of the city. So people say that peri-urbanites spend too much energy, use their cars too much, but you have numbers for all parts of the territory. We have the French Institute for the Environment, who said that you have one department disappearing every 10 years now, one department disappearing every 7 years, and the image that this conveys is that we're going, the whole territory is going to be all covered in concrete. That it is like the beginning of the end. And yet, the French National Institute of the Environment has seen. I mean, there's a survey that's shown that on average you have 850 square meters per inhabitant when you share out not just housing but also services, etc., infrastructure. And so it means that if you apply 850 square meters per inhabitant, you multiply 850 square meters per the number of inhabitants, and you say all this is covered in concrete, that's only covers 10% of the territory. And if you look at the numbers now, it's only 9%. So you go from 9 to 10%. So it does mean if there's urban extension, urban sprawling, or urban scattering, it means that rural areas are being encroached upon, and the re-urbanization of rural areas are something of a challenge. But the thing is, so where should urban extensions take place? But it's not a matter of how much there is, because it really isn't much at all compared to the entire territory. 90% of the territory is still unbuilt, undeveloped. Now, you might ask, what is the future of peri-urbia in sustainable development terms? Well, you have theories saying that peri-urbia is a real challenge to sustainable development. These theories are very successful, but when you look at them, the arguments do not hold water, do they? They are not very, very strong at all. So there seems to be a bias on the part of analysts, intellectuals, against peri-urbia, peri-urbanites. And this is something that dates back many years, even in the United States. You may remember William White, who was one of the spiritual fathers of Jen Jacobs, and then there was Herbert Gans, who took over after this, saying, who are the peri-urbanites? What do they believe? And William White used to say, well, suburbanites, as opposed to peri-urbanites. And it's not exactly the same thing at all, in fact. But he said suburbans or suburbanites the suburbs are the space of organization. So it's not the same thing as the National Front, but the suburbanite is the very narrow-minded person who consumes the right thing, has very strict and stringent principles. Maybe there is a correspondence there. So people live in small houses, and then everything is very petty, and people have garden gnomes in there to to decorate their gardens, but everything is all very closed in and narrow-minded. Well, but with this business of clubization, this is very much, it is up your street, isn't it? I mean, you're the one who mentions it. I mean, you're the one who referring to people living in this sort of a small inner club. Well, let me get back first to politics. If you Peri-Urbia is a laboratory of, as it were, experiment with local or urban development. And François Locot had a theory about this, but we can actually discuss this here, saying, well, neighborhoods are disappearing, people are so mobile that it doesn't really matter what your neighborhood is, because you can move, and so you, everybody has a metropolitan life over a very broad and disseminated surface. That has been said, but others say, well, no, the local neighborhood does make a difference, and people are attached to their neighborhoods. They talk about the small village around their homes, and that does make a difference. And I said, well, that's all very well, but you haven't got an urban village anymore. But what is it if it's, and what's the difference between the close area and the residential area? And that's the concept of the club, a club as opposed to a village. And that you can see, especially in small towns, 80% of towns in France have fewer than 2,000 inhabitants, so they're close to villages, and that's the difference between urban and peri-urban life, because in peri-urbia, it does make a difference if you have live in a village of fewer than 2,000 inhabitants. Well, no, they are not political communities. They are clubs. You have an utilitarian relationship to the environment. It's a club more than a administrative or a political unit. But, I mean, that's one way of looking at things. But for me, and this is my interpretation, the issue is not to to attack these residential clubs. And indeed, people tend to join these social clubs, and of course, they tend to be to refer to a certain social class. I mean, the higher social class attracts. Social classes of a feather attract each other, and so that's what happens. That's how the new division is shaping up. I'm not saying there are clubs of rich and clubs of the poor, but the real question is what are the rich going to give to the poor? What are the rich clubs going to the poor? Well, you sound like a football fan, and especially in the context of the champions, the club championship. You seem to have a nostalgia for the way it used to be, where the rich clubs used to subsidize the poorer clubs. Right. Well, that's a. That takes us away from the concept of sustainable development. What do you have to say, Hélène, about this? Well, yes, people tend to say, well, peri-urbanites, they have all the houses that have poor thermal balances, they have gas-guzzling cars. But are you saying that detached houses have a good environmental balance, a good energy balance? But still, 26% of the French live in old houses that were built, the Phoenix houses, I mean, these prefabricated houses, they have a good thermal balance, don't they? Well, if you look at the budget of a household, the big expense is not home, is not transportation, it's food and consumer goods. And so everybody has to eat. Those who have the largest footprint in terms of food are those who spend money on original foods, and people who have usually a higher income, organic food or people eating out in restaurants. I mean, that makes a big difference. If you haven't got much income, you do not go out for food, but everybody eats, and I'm not saying that a peri-urbanite should eat differently from an urbanite. Everybody consumes goods as well, and one of the big issues today today are consumer goods, and that is the second highest item on the energy balance and the budget. And of course, there are performance differences in terms of mobility. Some are more mobile than others, but there are ways to improve this, to improve the carbon footprint of mobility in peri-urbia. So, in fact, peri-urbia does not have more emissions than the urban centers. And indeed, on for the lower the income, in fact, you find that the lower the footprint. Now, the question is resilience. Can people resist an economic shock? Do they have resilience? I mean, when the price of oil or when the price of gasoline goes up, what happens to these people? If the price goes up too far, it creates issues of economic survival and how to get to work if you can't afford the gas. The sort of price pressure on these households is a real challenge. It has to be addressed by all sorts of means, and maybe the government can do something. But in terms of the productive force of peri-urbia, so here economic performance, on if you have a more disseminated area, you have more room or more roof surface per inhabitant, so you can create more energy, you can have a bigger garden, you can grow more vegetables, that sort of thing. And so it looks as though a peri-urbanite in energy terms is in a better position than an urbanite in terms of energy production, in terms of additional income. It could be through generation of energy, through growing your own vegetable, saving money, or indeed generating income. And so because there's this potential income, at least this economic potential, that should be done. Well, hang on. People have, it's a matter of choice, isn't it? Well, never mind the political choice, and I have no experience on that, no expertise on that, but the behavioral choice, and if you look at the weak signals coming from in terms of transition, we've been monitoring this for years. 5 years ago, when they talk about carpools, nobody believed in it, but now it does happen, it does exist. Creation of additional income, renting out your property on eBay, or sharing your vegetable patch with others. Well, not many people do have vegetable patches in France. Well, you'd be surprised. People with a home with a garden, unused garden, you're talking about millions of square meters, and that could be used for peri-urban agriculture. I'm not saying that it's easy to do, but the potential is there. The potential is there. And that would mean not just having your own vegetables, but to sell them, and so there would be other income. We had this video on consumption as opposed to production, but individuals are potential producers of goods and services, even of energy. So we have some signals about consumption behavior, but also organizational behavior, also using social networks. I think there is a way out. Instead of seeing people are stuck in their homes and just consuming and not producing anything, I think some of the small trends, some of the signals are showing up to say that this is emerging. Is this going to double, decouple over the years? We don't know, but it's happening. So a matter of choice, that is an important issue. But do people live in peri-urbia out of choice or because they have to? I mean, we mentioned this yesterday. What do you believe? What do you think? Well, for us economists, well, you have to make a choice. When you make a choice, it's because you have an obligation somewhere. There's no such thing as a completely free choice, and just as well, because you make a choice because you have constraints, you have conditions to say you want to have a dog, you have two or three children, you need space. You cannot find this in a city center. So because of these conditions, I mean, you talk about a centrifuge for the poor, one of these. You push out the poor to the outside, and you pull in the richer to the inside. I mean, this is to do with income. But when you talk about a club, Clubization. We have to look at the club in the English sense of the word, not a football club. If you read Blake and Mortimer, the comic strip, people in England spend more time in their clubs than in Britain, and women are not allowed, by the way. So if you look at this, no, you have girls serving coffee in the clubs. Well, this is a bit macho, isn't it? Well, never mind. No, but I mean, there's one thing, a club where you're an active member, as opposed to Pay-Urbia, where you're a member of the club, but you are on a back foot. In other words, very often you stay away from your family, you're not well integrated with other members, all the members of the club, and the very way in which a club works is not, I mean, is not streamlined. Everybody can fit in a way, and within these clubs, within these peri-urban clubs, I mean, you do have such factors as a higher price of gasoline, but you still will find positive phenomena as opposed to people falling back on their identities, on their ethnic or national identity. You will have more openness. It would be interesting to see how these clubs work. So the sort of trend expressed by the National Front, people harping back to their national identity, this is not a real trend. What do you have to say to that?
Well, in France, in Europe, and even more so in the US, there's a political, a societal debate about the desirable types of spatial organization, and it does seem that dense, urbanized forms of organization are privileged, especially in the more legitimate categories that Eric Charles was talking about, the most cultivated, the more affluent. Well, it's not as clear-cut as that, but also the most active politically. Politicized societies, political societies have made a choice earlier on for the denser city. Well, there are a couple of models, to put it roughly, in the world. So, well, there is one model that owns up to the fact that using the benefits of concentration had better accept exposure to the other, so public spaces, public transport, and another model where concentration is not rejected because everyone is an urbanite. Now, we're saying that these are all variants of on a common theme, but you try and restrict exposure to the other as much as possible. What I found was interesting in a performance by the artist is that he considers that at the end of the day, the peri-urban is very similar to another way of managing distance than co-presence or mobility, which is telecommunication. And here, one thing is in common, you don't expose your body. Whereas when you go out in the world, you expose your body. And so there's a debate here, but at the global level, this is a debate that has opened up, and also because most of urbanization is taking place in Asia. And after trying on various models, Asian cities in China in particular are now switching to towards accepting dense cities, more public transport than cars, restricting car use, because this is what is necessary if you want to have density. People in Asia love density, they don't want to renounce density, and there's no peri-urbanization, and anyway, it would be difficult. But there are obvious implications, and so the center of gravity in this debate between the two models is tilting towards a model which, it seems to me, I'm not putting the blame on any model, but it seems more consistent. If you choose to have cities, well, you can reject cities. There were models of the driving society. It was thought that there would be general scattering, random distribution of people and business, but you see that it's not as productive. So as long as you own up to this rationale of concentration, then it's more logical to follow it to the end. You're not pro-Chinese here. No. Don't misunderstand me. The real issue when Eric Charme started talking about me, but then he said, well, look at the law. Well, I'm not writing a law. If the political class now in most European countries and increasingly elsewhere in Asia in particular, but also in North America, consider that it's more logical and more consistent on the it makes more sense on the three pillars of sustainable development, not just carbon emissions and mileage traveled, which doesn't make sense in terms of the natural environment because it depends on how much you spend and consume to travel that distance. But there's a simple thing, that the surface economy is rather efficient. Surface savings in surface area are more efficient. It uses fewer natural inputs and there's more creativity. You'll have more serendipity, more opportunities to create unexpected things. It so happens that there's a certain convergence around the fact that if you really want to have a focus on saving surface areas, then you need to really follow that logic to the end. No, things seem to balance out. This is what Martine Berger showed yesterday with her colleague. In a region like Île-de-France, where the slope of urban sprawl seems to have decreased, which is not the case in Toulouse, for instance, there are two different bases here. Well, it seems that the peri-urban areas seem to be denser. There are no airtight borders between the two. It would be like saying that southern countries will produce the bulk of goods in the country in the world. Well, it would no longer be southern countries, and so there is more density in the peri-urban now. It's now no longer just for residential purposes. And so mobility patterns are becoming different. And so I think that there may be different dynamics at play here with more permeable borders. There would be less single-purpose sprawl in the peri-urban with more density. Now everything is open, it seems. And discussing it with the people concerned, I'm not putting a stigma here because I think that society ought to choose and peri-urbanites should be active in that. But then there's the issue of secession. Where is the decision made? And now, the issue of isolation in a country like France, the peri-urban world has a political advantage which has been inherited from rurality, which was a major priority in an agriculture-based country like France in the past. And so they make decisions that have consequences on metropolitan spaces without being involved in the same decision-making processes. And so I think this is where we should talk together. There may be a few losses of privileges along the way, but I think that this is the challenge. Eric Charme. Well, I'm not stigmatizing here, but in some publications, the various models that you're talking about, especially models where you would be mostly urban areas illustrated by the Amsterdam case, and the other extreme would be the Johannesburg case. When you're using Johannesburg as an example, you're putting a stigma because it's a very specific case that's very iconic of very tense social and political situations. It's not a model you can aspire to. It would make more sense to oppose Amsterdam and Los Angeles. So, Eric Charme, what Jack Levy has in mind when he's talking about the peri-urban, it's Johannesburg. It was the apartheid. Johannesburg, it doesn't exist anymore. Yes, I agree with you. I think that The example I would take now would be Los Angeles, or rather a smaller city, because there's a metro now in Los Angeles. So I would take a smaller city. If I really wanted to have my finger on the pulse of the world, I would have taken a city in Arizona, Phoenix, for instance, which has a phenomena very close to Johannesburg without this strong top-down approach from the political sector. Well, regarding research in the peri-urban, I haven't conducted any research personally, but some research was conducted after what you wrote, and this is where you have contributed to the debate. There's a lack of political and scientific debate here. Everyone's tweeting in their own corner, but Jean-Luc Rivière has written research about voting patterns in the Cannes region. Mrs. Girard wrote about periurbia in the Lyon region, and she wrote a paper in Libération and Métropolitique, and Lambert wrote a PhD thesis about voting patterns. I have students who worked on these issues. And what comes out of it is that votes are determined socially first. It so happens that in periurbia there are certain social categories. And what Rivière showed is that in certain small communes with many voting stations, where the National Front is strongest, it's in the centers of villages. It's the indigenous populations that vote most for the National Front because they can see suburbia arriving, non-whites, people of Northern African descent, for instance, who have joined the middle class, and they buy detached houses, which leads to tension with the indigenous populations. Maybe at the same time, since we're talking about that, maybe we could show the map that I had. Let's come to the map then. We can see that it's a socially determined vote. What you can see on the maps, I don't know whether we can show them. I hope they will, says the moderator. There's a vote for the National Front in peri-urban rings, but in the far-off peri-urban rings. Periurbia is not just low-income areas. I worked on Châteaufort, which is a town in the Yvelines department, but people moving into Châteaufort now are couples of white-collar workers who earn 10,000 euros a month with significant money to make a down payment on houses. This is a 1,500 inhabitant municipality that is bang on the club model. And at the latest election, her Marine Le Pen score was 6.83%. It's 25 kilometers from central Paris, but kids go to Versailles for high school. And anyway, people there never go to Paris, and they work around there. There's a lot of employment in Saclay. They are near a natural park. They are very well located, they can access a lot of resources, and they don't vote that much for Marine Le Pen, but they live in detached houses. It's a peri-urban town that is the embodiment of the peri-urban dream. And so here, you ought to explain why there's an under-representation of the FN vote. And now there's an over-representation here. You can see regional differences. It's mostly in northeast and the south that the people vote for the FN. But if you look at Paris, Lyon, the further you go from the center, the bigger the increase. That doesn't mean that everyone votes for the National Front. Some people vote for the left. These are percentages anyway. There's an over-representation of the FN vote. But there are, let's take two towns. There's one called Thion, which is right under the runways of Charles de Gaulle Airport. And I worked on a town called Crécy with mostly executives. On the one hand, you've got the handlers, luggage handlers buying houses. And on the other side, you've got the pilots. In Thieu, Marine Le Pen scored over 35%, and in the next town, her score was 20. That's a decent score, 20, but it was around the average, and so the overrepresentation was where the lower-income families buy their first homes, and maybe you could explain why these low-income households vote more for the FN. Well, you gave the explanation, if I'm not mistaken. If you call things by their name, it's xenophobia. No, not directly. If you say that when Arabs arrive in a town and people vote for the FN, that's xenophobia. There are various motivations. There are indigenous populations, as it were. Here, there's a problem with the changing environment. The environment is being transformed. People think that they can't control these changes. And there's this form of racism in Charvieux-Chavagneux, Pontchirui, in the eastern suburbs of Lyon. There were rulings that were rejected because the mayors had decided to preemptively buy houses on racist grounds. Preemptive buying by municipalities, it's in the east of Lyon, Charvieux-Chavagneux, Pontchirui. These are residential towns with a lot of industrial blue-collar jobs around, and there are workers, households of lower middle class. People are well established and they buy homes. And it's impossible to know the percentages because, you know, we've got no ethnic statistics in France, but we don't know how many of them are non-whites, and that's why the municipality preemptively bought the property. In the ruling that was rendered by the Cour de Cassation, a family with a Turkish-sounding name wanted to buy a house, and the municipality preemptively bought the property, and it was turned over by the Cour de Cassation. So now, I was talking about the indigenous populations, but people moving into the far peri-urban, that's a real post-colonial reversal, talking about indigenous populations for people living in French villages. Yes, it is. But now, blue-collar workers, one-third of home buyers have less than 2,500 euros in income for the whole household. So these are people of immigrant descent, or there's a blue-collar culture, people who vote massively for the left and who don't vote for the FN. But there's another section of that population. People are running away from the suburbs. They're running away from the banlieues and urban ghettos to raise their children. So they have a really negative discourse about these major housing estates. But they move into these towns where already white households are living. They want to run away from a social environment that they see negatively. And one criterion that's used to appreciate the extent, the social status of a neighborhood is the color of skins, the concentration of Arabs or blacks, which means that this is a bad social status. And when they see that in their district, the so-called Maghrébins are following, then they see that negatively. That's the first sign, and this is where you move beyond xenophobia. There are people who earn 2,400 euros a month. They take on a mortgage to buy their 150,000 euro house, and then they have transport expenditures, if the Crozet can express that better than I would. But they spend hundreds of euros a month, so you spend 1,000 euros a month to buy food, to have your house and move around, and you don't have collective transport. There are school buses in the evening and the morning, but you don't have any crèches or canteens, school canteens, so it's very difficult for these families to manage the schedules of their children. So that's why the women stop working, and so there's a drop in income. The man has to work overtime. And these were people who were predisposed to hear about assisted the welfare scroungers and so on. And you can see how the National Front discourse makes its way into the heads of these people. So you're clearly on the side of constraints versus choice. Well, I think that the theme of the roundtable was not the National Front vote. I can keep talking about that, but during the election, I heard a lot of astounding things. A Le Monde correspondent went to Hénin Beaumont, said that it's a town of detached houses, but that's not true. These were houses built for the miners over a century ago. Don't say too many bad things about journalists in my presence, says the moderator. Well, that requires more information. That's the problem of these 2 days. I think that the main options, political options, whether you want a dense city or low-density city, that's irrelevant, completely irrelevant. China has opted for dense. India is doing the opposite. So there's no unified rule. There's a political debate in the UK, the US about that, but right now France is in denial. When you take a look at legislation, we want to put a stop to phenomena that are considered as abnormal, and urban planners are still in this sort of denial. Well, I publish papers and I conduct research, but I'm mostly linked to operational decision making. I've never been involved in a suburban operation. There is no such thing in France. Most urban projects that have been documented, and most urban projects that get funded, and that are only a small amount of new builds, are in a very dense urban areas. Now we are subsidizing high-rise buildings in La Défense. So resources are poorly allocated and design is poorly distributed in this suburban or peri-urban French territory, because this territory is underdeveloped. There are no operators. People don't care about it. There are no flagship operations. And just cross the border, and you'll see that it's not very different elsewhere in other countries. Underinvestment in peri-urbia, according to you. Yes, intellectually and financially so, yes. If you go to architectural schools or where urban planner training centers, that's a fact. I also teach there, so I know what I'm talking about. And there's underinvestment in most of these areas, but there's no policy of free spaces. I'm not talking about Switzerland, it's outside Europe, but if you go to Alpine countries, it's particularly visible. Germany, Austria, Switzerland also, you can see that free spaces are organized spontaneously or not, and so diffuse urbanization is part of the built environment. That's quite obvious. I could have taken broad pictures to show you. In France, agricultural land stops at random near houses or not, but if you were in German-speaking Switzerland or in Austria, you could really see these clear-cut lines between planted areas and houses. And that's part of the way that low-density urban planning creates its own collective spaces, not public spaces, but collective spaces. Houses want to look cozy. Farmers force themselves to create boundaries in these countries, but that doesn't exist in France. That leads us to an endless debate about the issue of land consumption. Here you can give precise figures. I even have tables if you want to see that. We have the Terruti statistic. That's not the only one available, but people say that 70,000 hectares are paved over in France every year. There's very precise data about single family housing new projects. 12,000 hectares are destroyed every year for that purpose, and that means that around that there are a number of things, in particular linear infrastructure, especially transformation of wastelands, but none of that is actually managed. So it would be good to switch to the Austrian model, is that it? Well, let me finish with a third observation. France is the only European country that has not reformed its local authorities based on territorial transformations. We have stuck to the micro models of small municipalities with 36,000 municipalities. You get the idea that the territory is managed, but in fact, all these peripheral territories are left without the tools and instruments necessary to think about themselves. And there's no difference between Paris and the smallest village in France. And so this is Gaston Defferre's fault. Yes, in a way. He really made a mess of it deliberately. So Yves Thénault, before you have a debate with the rest of the audience at Carbone 4, talking about energy transition audits, you're thinking about how to get politicians more engaged in the peri-urban? Well, that's a very good question. The underinvestment in some territories is very evident if you look at the investment plan for the future or major projects that will cost billions of euros defended by the previous government or this one. Well, we've already talked about it, so I won't address that now, but these are projects that are mostly urban or infrastructure heavy, and they don't address these scattered territories. Very urban areas are diffuse, scattered with small municipalities and so on. If you want to invest in these territories, you may have a watering can policy where you give a few euros to everyone. So it's better to invest billions of euros in targeted projects than more scattered policies. And so that's why politicians want to bet heavily on it. But you need to have experimenting grounds to bring about a transition in the peri-urban, and for that you need public support. Local economic players can do something about it, but they have their limitations. What can they do, for instance? Well, they find limitations if they want to have an experiment with a high technological content, with self-sufficient houses, with batteries in the garage. If you want to do that yourself as an individual, it's not easy, so you need small experiments like that. There are too few of those. And the second thing, in the investment priorities for these sorts of experiments, I talked about urban agriculture that would require significant investment in areas that have land available that could be used differently. You talked about scale also. Can a commune do that? Can a community of communes do that? It's very difficult because the governance map does not match the territory, the spatial map. So we need more expertise in peri-urban agriculture, in agroecology also. We have a good laboratories, but not enough expertise. And last but not least, the European Commission is currently funding research work called new jobs for the economic and energy transition. Now we have scientific papers, and well, congrats to them for writing that. They say that part of the transition may have more physical jobs. We hear about service jobs, knowledge-based economy, but if we want to have a transition, we'll have to produce some renewable energy that are more labor-intensive than concentrated energy. We'll need to produce our farm resources more. We'll have to produce differently. And so in order to train people to acquire new skills, you can't create that out of the blue. You'll need investment in the soft infrastructure. This is essential if you want this transition to be successful, so that households in the peri-urban will not secede or be excluded. They need positive projects that they can aspire to and that they can get engaged in. And so there's the Petroplus refinery in Petit Couronne near Rouen, which is a hotbed of the National Front. And these are people who work with people of Arab descent, and they're very happy about it. But what they're mostly concerned about is their future, their professional future for the next 2 years, and how they can be retrained and acquire new skills. It's true that they live in a single family homes, and they really work their asses off, so to speak, to buy a home. But it depends on what type of project they want to become engaged. A lot of hands raised, a bearded gentleman. I don't know whether it's a coincidence. I'm looking for ladies here. It would be a good thing if we had more ladies speaking. Well, you already spoke yesterday. So first giving the floor to the ladies, to the younger audience, and those who didn't speak yesterday, you talked about telecommuting in Toulouse. Well, thank you very much. And Patricia Sajoust at Le Havre University. I have two comments. I'm not at all talking about voting patterns, but I think that as early as the 70s, you could read a number of papers saying that when the right wing was had power, they favored urban sprawl and the development, the rise of developments, in order to have a rise of conformists who would vote for the right. And we've been talking about the growth of the right wing since the 70s, so maybe this has an impact on the peri-urban. Well, it's linked to your question, so maybe we can give the floor to one of the internet participants, Yves Baron, new one. We didn't see that. He said, good question. Well, that's nice. We've talked about the FN vote in the peri-urban. What about the green vote? The FN vote, the green vote. Do you want to ask a question about politics and the peri-urban? Do you have a different question? Well, we'll take that later then. Vincent Kaufmann. Well, to add to what was said, a very quick question. What's the standard deviation of votes in municipalities? We've talked about the diversity in lifestyles, saying that lifestyles were very different. And here we're talking about the National Front vote that looks very uniform. But what's the standard deviation between the towns? Jean-Yves Grandjean, do you also have a question about politics? Yes, not about votes, but about two things. First of all, well, one thing that calls public policy into question about the social gradient of people who feel that they're left behind by the community. You may have read a recent article in Le Monde about the fact that students had to self-finance their studies more and more. There was a really shocking graph that showed that it was organized by Decile, and it showed that in the lower income social classes, students received a lot of grants. In the more affluent part of society, there were tax breaks. For instance, people maximized the fact that they had tax cuts when they had children. They bought subsidized real estate to pay for their children's study. And it was the medium deciles who had to put their children to work to self-finance their studies because they had no other way to pay for it. And more generally, it is related to urban development, which is at the center of the Sand Pyramid that Yves Crozet was talking about. For a lot of the population, that calls the urban space into question. People feel that national or local public policies are targeted towards the decision-maker, creative class, who have a lot of cultural policies and infrastructure built for them. And there's also a lot of social support for the disadvantaged, and those who are living in peri-urbia feel left behind. and they only have bank loans to help them finance their homes. That's the first thing. That's the first political aspect that is really key in our modern times. And the second thing is organization. Don't be too lengthy. Well, there's this scattering of communities, but that's essential for the future. You can hope for changes in intercommunality, as it's called in France, a community of communes. Maybe that will be a new scale of decision making, but in metropolitan areas, the reality will be that there will be taxation and solidarity. Peri-urbia is an area of under-taxation, but people who lament the lack of resources to do better, they are expecting money from regions and departments, but the coffers are empty, so there's under-taxation in peri-urban areas. Who'd like to answer to that, respond to that? Jacques Lévy.
Right, the relationship between financial flows and peri-urban distance. On the map, you can see there's no clear correlation between vote or the National Front vote and income. I mean, peri-urbia is rather neutral in terms of financial income, well, provided that you put together the two halves of peri-urbia. I mean, this is the Lord, the ring of the Lords, the first ring between the end of, say, suburbs and peri-urbia. So that the one closer to the city, that's where the income is higher, especially not Paris, but Nantes, Rennes, or Toulouse. You find that there's in that first ring, you have a higher income, and then when you get further down, then or further away, the income goes down, and then it's comparable to the central part, which is not high or low, it's a mixed picture, because that's where you have the highest economic diversity, contrary to common belief. So there's no clear correlation. It's not the poor peri-urbanized that vote for the National Front. There's no such thing as a direct correlation between income and political intention. People say it's not spatial, it's social, but spatial and social, I mean, where you live, spatial is who you are. I mean, it's a social choice, so or a social factor. So you can't get around that. And then there's something else that was said, and some have mentioned this, the fact that fiscal flows, financial flows from the public funds are mostly in favor of the less well urbanized areas. And so, and this was clearly illustrated, and I say that the poor of the rich regions finance or fund the rich of the poor regions. The schools of Saint-Denis, they haven't got much schools, but if you are a solicitor in Jarnac, you're doing all right. But even if you are a professor in Jarnac, you make more money than a professor in Paris. Jarnac being out in the provinces, and so the flows between central and local government is in favor, as I said, of the rich of the poor regions as opposed to the poor of the rich regions, and it's one in favor of the other, and so this means that if you want to address this, there has to be some fiscal redistribution, and that is the very reason why people are against it, because and this is not just in France, by the way. So that's one thing, and let me also address this issue of votes, because that is more to do with how well off you are. People tend to believe that if homeowners tend to vote to the right, that's a well-accepted concept. And that was true for quite some time. And if you look at the left-right ratio, it also depends on the electoral clientele. In other words, the left and the right have tried to keep their patrons, saying on the left we tend to defend home renters, and on the right we defend home owners. And I mean, it's a self-perpetuating system, isn't it? And so it's not just preferences, it's just the way the politics are organized. As to Vincent Kaufmann's question, would you find more higher standard deviations in peri-urbia than in urban centers? I really don't know. I don't think so. But everywhere you have lots of diversity. But if you look at the electoral map of the National Front, it's a dual map. I mean, there's a regional aspect, and then there's an aspect of urban. Urban differentiation, depending on how urban you are. So if you move from the center to periphery, to the outside, from the center to the outside, you have more votes for the extreme and mostly the National Front. That was more the case last year than in the previous elections. But if you look at the general level, it does vary from region to region, from one part of the country to another. So you really have to look at both criteria. For instance, in the west of France, the National Front, by and large, is not as strong as in the east or in the south, in the PACA, in the Riviera region. Well, income redistribution in France, you have to recognize that the policies are such that there's no, I mean, local taxes are not gradual. It's unfair. In other words, occupancy tax in Paris is not higher than in a small village, and that's unfair. I mean, you have poor villages where your occupancy tax is as high as in rich cities. And of course, if the tax is not levied in a fair way, well, it will not be distributed in a fair way. That's one thing. Now, regarding tax or income redistribution, you have to think hard about the extent to which there is redistribution. For instance, if you look at it on the département level, and there was a paper in Le Monde, an article in Le Monde yesterday or the day before, clearly the more urban or urbanized départements subsidize the less well urbanized département. If you look at the detail of this, it's not true at all. And then if you look at this in terms of public investment, it's the other way around. Public investment, well, you have ways of reading the maps. Well, major public investment is the reserve of the more urbanized areas, especially for public transportation. Nothing is being done at all for less well urbanized areas. Well, on the one hand, you look at infrastructure. Well, of course, the road network is mostly for the disseminated areas, for the less urbanized areas. That's one thing. About the votes now, and Jean-Michel Roux said, well, we're here to discuss peri-urban planning, etc., rather than the National Front, the vote for the National Front. But the two are related. They still are related. Because you can think of in serious terms about peri-urban planning if you stop to think of it as a disease, as a pathological space. And, hang on, nobody says this apart from Télérama, but who reads Télérama? Well, people do read Télérama, and Télérama has these front covers saying the ugly France, etc. And we can see that when you look at politics and the representation of the country, you never mention peri-urban areas. The camera never stops on peri-urbia. You look at the countryside, you look at the city, but the zone in between is completely overlooked. And so there's quite a bit of work to be done. And when you look at the, say, housing policies, you look at Paris itself and the immediate outskirts. Now, about the vote, Annie Fourcault was here, and she has worked a lot on this defective housing between the wars, and the Communist Party thrived in these poor dwellings. And Châteaufour, I believe, is a right-wing community where of course you have white-collar upper management workers, and they were very much involved in the creation of the National Park in the Chevreuse Valley, and you have environmental challenges. It's not just voting for the right, it's also voting for the ecologists, and so you have historical reasons for that. And so environmental attitudes are also there to feed conservative discourse. People say, well, we should stop building houses if we are to protect the environment. But then if you cannot have your own detached house, then you move out to Périurbia. Well, but what about then the green vote? How does it translate? Well, I haven't got the numbers, but I can tell you that attitudes are more ecological. So are you saying that people who voted for the right will vote for the Greens? I mean, is that what's going to happen? Well, there is a sort of a center-right environmentalist position. Well, listen, you can't necessarily divide homeowners and home renters in terms of A, voting or how they vote and what they do to renovate their homes. Some homes are indeed thermal wastelands, and they require a lot of work. But very often, you cannot get things going unless there's some major financial support from government. But these things are not just one way. It's not just money going there. It can generate jobs. It can generate more potential. So, of course, Périurbia is in a difficult position, but it is also has a potential. It has a potential that can certainly be put to fruition. Now, in the Paris area, you have the energy positive energy buildings, and the idea is to use that model to rehabilitate apartment buildings. But in isolated areas, Saint-Brieuc, where you have these thermal sieves, as it were, there is one. There's the German bank KMV, which is the French, the German equivalent of deposits. Bank of which collects all savings accounts. Why can't we do that? There's a German bank that can do this, and in the Saint-Brieuc area, you could do just that. Well, that's exactly what we're trying to do, because we're saying the Caisse des Dépôts and the Public Investment Bank should invest in these disseminated areas. But it's not just money being injected, it's also a source of employment, a sort of jobs. Well, thank you for such a positive response. Four microphones. You kept the microphone. I said I had two comments. Okay. Well, I would like to say something about the consumption of land in rural areas, especially in Gironde, in the southwest of France. We had 7% of the farming surface was consumed, but half of this for fallow land, and in the remainder, only 20% was for building. And so you tend to stigmatize Périurbia, saying that you build left, right, and center. By the way, there is building does not necessarily mean development doesn't necessarily mean building housing. And some of the development was for agricultural purposes, and some of the money may well be used for that. But what Richard said, I think 90% of the small towns with fewer than 2,000 people, but for the for INSEE, for the statistical office, if you have fewer than 2,000 inhabitants, you're a village, you're not a town. And Martin Schuller yesterday showed that the indicators that distinguish between urban, rural, and peri-urban, these indicators change from one country to the next. And if you did not take on board the commuting between work and home, then the rural area would be a lot bigger, and the rural areas would be much more resilient. And INSEE found that three-quarters of the French live in rural areas. No, so apparently you've been working about you've been working on rural areas for the past 10 years, even though you claim to be a peri-urban expert. I would like to respond to what was just said. I am somewhat embarrassed by what we hear. We say the whole world has become urban, and it is not the way people. That's not the experience on the territory. If you go see the people, if you see the way political life is organized, if you look at the geography, I mean, maybe we should drop a list of experts. And tell them that these rural experts are in fact peri-urban experts. I mean, but you have reasons to believe that not everything is urban or peri-urban. I mean, the rural France does exist and has its specificities. And so maybe we are being a bit simplistic here. And Mrs. Le Tenneau said this quite clearly. You can see that there is a bit of self-organization going on between rural areas and urban areas. But when we refer to peri-urban self-organization, it's not been considered, but you could see in peri-urban areas, you have emerging towns, you have these emerging poles, and that's, as it were, at the crossroads between rural and urban zones. One person at a time. Hello. My name is Natalia Ribas, and I'm a researcher in Spain, and I would like to speak English.
Okay, I will ask my question in English.
Shortly, please.
Okay. It's a question about models. So I just wanted to put, you know, like to understand these peri-urban models. So we have to understand terminology and models at the same time. So I'll just put a question like to whoever wants to answer in the at the table. So the first question was like, if you, somebody can, you know, like define a little bit how we translate these terms, because if they call it suburban in English and peri-urban, and then if they match and or they don't match exactly, how do we translate those terms? And then about models, when we think about models, and now we are centered on the Franco-Francais model, so how do we travel, or we sport, or we don't sport that model? I think that would be interesting to see. So, first of all, in the video we saw like the exaggerated generation of the suburban model, but that's been sported also. So I thought when we saw the video outside of the Turkish model in one of the videos, that's part of this suburban model, which has developed into gated communities and has been exported to Cairo or to other places in the world. So those models also are exported somehow, no? Like they are not so only American. So we should see how these models go. Or for example, if we think about the French model, and this has not been talked much about, this is in the surface, you know, like the model which was very American, no? Like Carrefour, Decathlon, Auchan. This you find it exactly in Spain, in the periphery. So how the French and the French power economy has exported that model to Europe. Nobody has referred to that, and I think that's very interesting. So there's been an implementation of that same model in other parts of Europe. So just to have all these questions in mind in how these models do travel. And finally, I would also add, so if we have to, you know, to see this in like with global lenses and facing the crisis also, how do we see this mapping then? It's not a matter of like a global centers of finance that they have also, you know, a translation into this urbanity in a way, in the kind of interpretation of a Saskia Sassen's models of the global cities. So how would we put our new peri-urban models into that global mapping? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Muchas gracias.
Thank you for that question, and we will certainly answer it. And the gentleman, yes, my name is Gérard Denis from the Administration for Sustainable Development, about land development. It's true that housing only accounts for a small part of the total. A significant part is also for road infrastructure, which usually go hand in hand with the development of detached housing. But you also have retail, you have parking areas, a lot of space is used for that. And somebody said that everybody lived in detached housing in Peri-Urbia at 850 square meters per inhabitant. You would only cover 10% of the territory, and now we already stand at 9%, which seems to be a paradox. But it is true that every 7 of 8 years is completely covered over. That means that there's 1% of the territory being covered every 7 years. So in 7 years' time, we'd have 10% of the territory covered. But that's compatible because the 850 square meters does not look at the rest, that is the building of roads. It's just detached housing plus gardens. But if you take everything else on board the roads, it's more 850, it's more like 2,000 square meters. No, hang on. We're not looking at what goes with detached housing development. It's peri-urban development. If you build an airport, let's talk about that, you create something which is as big as a town, as a city. And it's not directed for peri-urbia. It's for the urban context in general. I mean, the entire city is concerned when you extend infrastructure. Yes, and the 850 square meters takes on board, it's not just the home and the garden per inhabitant, it is all the developed surfaces, including infrastructure, shops, etc., office space, etc. So it's 800 to 900 square meters. And you're talking about growth rates, seven departments, one department every 7 or 8 years, and that's 1% of the territory. But very quickly, you get to the point where the entire country will be peri-urban. But peri-urbanization is a densification of rural areas. Rural areas are those that take up the most surface area. So it's not a quantitative issue, it's a qualitative issue, and that is in line with what I said earlier on. Why is it that so much farming goes fallow and gets ready for peri-urbanization? It's because peri-urbanization is not a continuous sprawling of a concrete slab. It's the emergence of a multitude of small villages around the country. I think in the Paris area, we're talking at about 1,796 towns, almost as many around Lyon. So if you had a continuous development, of course, that would have much less impact. But it's not continuous, it's discrete. And that would make a big difference. And that, otherwise, you wouldn't have anticipated peri-urbanization 50 kilometers away from Lyon. And so to respond to what was said, in the Paris area, you have 12 million people and 1,700 small towns. Nothing is going to happen unless all mayors agree to some things. And when you have, I mean, if you look at these small clusters of towns, on average 10 towns together, that's not going to make much difference. Yes, and since we're talking about the Paris area and the difference between rural areas and urban areas. And we could have said this after Martin Schuller's presentation. There is an European indicator taken up by the French INSEE, the statistics office. And what used to be considered a village in France below 2,000. Now, according to European studies, you still are a village with as many as 5,000 inhabitants. You need to have 300 inhabitants per square kilometer and have as much as 5,000 kilometers. Beyond, you have to have more than that to qualify as a town and not a village anymore. But 5,000 people is an awful lot of people. I mean, that's... and especially if you want a density of 300 inhabitants per square kilometer, if you haven't got that, you're still a village. Well, this urban-rural divide, you have an issue of density or urban intensity. Population density or urban intensity, that's true. But there are borders, or you can try and draw lines between what is more or less urbanized. That may well be. But in any case, you all agree to the fact that what used to make the rural area so unique was that it had its own rules of operation, which no longer exist. By the way, in my region of Aquitaine, you can see this very clearly, and it's a very recent development. This died out in the 60s or 70s. I'm talking about the end of a self-regulated rural world. Well, that brings grist to my mill. You shouldn't confuse rural landscapes, countryside landscapes, which is what you're referring to, just like you had towns in medieval society. They were a component of the rural world because, of course, many aspects of the country depended on the city and vice versa. Now, what you have is the opposite. These countryside landscapes with urban forms, that these urban constructs can emerge that are reminiscent of former rural areas, but the people who live in low density areas now are blue-collar workers, people they're in the, manufacturing workers as opposed to farm workers or agricultural workers. So you have an interesting parallel here. If you look at hyper-urban or infra-urban areas, there are big differences between that and the central urban areas. And it's a bit unfortunate to use the same words to describe different things, because you still have lots of rural areas around the world, if not in France, than in China and India. And so we use the same words to refer to very different situations. So when we use the word peri-urban and suburban, are we referring to the same thing? Suburbia refers to the North American version of the urban sprawl. This is what I would call suburbia. Should we use suburban as opposed to suburbia to describe the various gradients of urbanism, that is, the non-city dwellers, that is, everything but the city dweller, or against? I mean, there's almost an opposition, isn't there? And both in North America and in Europe, but okay, let's be even more descriptive there. These non-city dwellers would be suburban or peri-urban, but what we refer to as the banlieue, the suburbs in Europe, the relationship between the city and the suburbs is very different in Europe than it is elsewhere. You have possible means of integration. You have more density building up, and so slowly but surely the suburbs are conglomerated with the city. In what we call the first ring around Paris, you have towns in that first ring, the first row, as it were, of the suburban towns around Paris, are being slowly but surely integrated within the central area. So it's a completely different logic, a completely different situation from what you have, say, in other European suburbs that were built in the industrial era. And that's what we that's the equivalent of, in social terms, as of the inner cities in North America. And the urban ghettos are located outside the cities in Europe, but in the inner cities in Europe. So you must be clear about this. The relationship is quite different. Yes, well, let me just finish with one sentence to address this issue of urban versus rural. In this universe, in this urban universe with a sort of a social sort of homogeneity, you have, oh, more to the point, with which has become widespread and commonplace. You have to see the way in which that space is divided up in plots, in areas where you have not just housing areas, but also farming areas, etc. Somehow, you have to take all these components on board. I'm not saying that you should be able to regulate everything, but this diversity should be taken as a whole. But the way in which the policies are defined now, that's impossible because you draw dividing lines between things that are really that belong together. Well, on the rural front, and it's interesting that we're returning to that. 90% of the towns in France have fewer than 2,000 inhabitants, 85% in the Paris area. These towns are like villages. I mean, they call their places a village. They don't think of themselves as peri-urbanite, but these have nothing to do with rural villages. That's why we refer to these as a residential club. They're no longer a village. They're not towns either. That's why I call them clubs. All right, then. Well, we are running 15 minutes late, but so you have to be brief. There are four of you who want to take the floor, and then the guests will answer. And we have 10 minutes, because at 11:20, we'll have to take the break, so 20 minutes behind schedule. I have a question about let's start with the example of National Front vote. Lots of work has been done about this, phenomenon, and the interesting is to see the interaction between the way people vote and the party's political strategies. And if you want to look at peri-urban votes for the National Front, you have to see what is the strategy. The strategy of National Front is directed at peri-urbia and rural areas. And National Front is also describing itself as the party of motorists, of car drivers, and so maybe that should be that you should be see a connection between policies and votes. I'm Laurent Thévaux, and I live in Lausanne, and I have a question from Hélène Le Ténot about the sustainability of territories. I come from a country where everybody, from the federal government through down to the local or regional authorities, public and private organizations, everyone considers that our environmental footprint is mostly due to housing and mobility, but you seem to think otherwise. I'm surprised about that. And then Olivier Klein. Olivier Klein is taking the floor, so we should all run for cover. Well, I'm interested in the economy of transportation, of my thinking. What I found interesting is that everybody seems to think that there's a lack of political project for certain parts of the metropolitan territory, and that there was sort of a and as a trade-off, there was more political and financial investment towards the central urban areas. So it looks as though the overall vision of the city, as seen by the political class, the idea is to draw in the higher echelons of society or successful companies that or export-driven companies, etc. So that's all very well. I mean, these economic powerhouses are being driven out there. That seems to be the policy. Now, it's happening on the territorial, on the French level. Is it not happening globally? And if you look at, I mean, if you look at France as a whole, but in fact, this political project of global of urbanization may be leaving behind other territories. I mean, when we talk about the peri-urban areas, some things simply are not happening. People are left behind.
So about the globalization of the political discourse and a specific question to Hélène de Tenoux. Well, I'll take this question and don't know whether it's possible to show slide 9 in my presentation. In my consultancy with GF1, we created the ECO2 climate indicator that expresses the CO2 greenhouse gas emissions associated to the consumption of French households. We looked at all expenditures in the millions of euros, and we looked at how much it meant in terms of direct or indirect emissions. For instance, by a computer, it was manufactured abroad, and what were the associated emissions? If you rank the various items, the two biggest emitters are food and consumer goods. Those that come behind and right behind are mobility and energy consumption for the house. But they rank second, and then utilities, education, healthcare, and then construction of houses. That's really way behind. Why do people keep talking about building and transport? Well, these are two main prerogatives of national governments. And in a French context, when there was the environmental roundtable, agriculture was not part of the purview of the Minister of the Environment who conducted the talks. So there was a lot of talk about building and transport, but not about agriculture in this Grenelle de l'Environnement. And so if you see the priorities here amongst these items, of course, it's all relative. You can find 12 different ways of calculating it. It's only the CO2 indicator. If you look at arable land or water, that would be different. But on the y-axis, you've got emissions in CO2 equivalent. So you've got food and consumer goods. How many manufactured goods do we consume, shared use, eco-design? But households are also vulnerable, and so what seems very important is food and, of course, mobility and energy consumption, but don't forget food. And regarding globalization and the political discourse, who'd like to answer, Jacques Lévy? Well, I can. The cities that work best productivity-wise based on the criteria of the most economics-centered currents to denounce it or praise them are the general city, the more diverse cities that have the more public spaces and the most public transport and parks. So there's no divide between economic growth and sustainable urban development. If you follow the Brundtland report, economic growth is one of the pillars, and that works well for the city. That's why society has taken the matter into its hand. I can see that the more density there is, the more diversity there is, and the more it works on all usual measures of development. So it's the debate is not between rejecting or turning our backs on the Paris region playing its role on the global front to make it nicer to live with better social relationships and make it more environmentally friendly. That's not at all how it works. Eric Charme. Well, about that, be careful about scale. If you look at continental scales, there is a concentration of wealth in urban centers that have high economic growth, and wealth production is concentrated there, because then there's a lot of deconcentration thanks to redistribution in France. Okay, that's okay for France, but then the question is how the city itself is organized. There's concentration in urban centers, but then how are they organized? The US is the archetypal example of urban sprawl, and it looks very economically dynamic. No, you need a better productivity per capita than Los Angeles, where there's more density and diversity. If you compare per capita productivity of cities compared to the country of reference, it works every time. Overall, these are the cities in European countries that have the best ratios, and in countries like the US, where you have both models, you can see that New York or Boston have better results than Los Angeles. 2 minutes left. Every time we talk about that, such benchmarks, you tend to forget scale, especially the fact that the data in each country are provided at specific scales that are different from one another. So in fact, productivity per capita in city centers is probably higher than peri-urban areas, but not everyone can have the same productivity. If you think about relatively low-skilled jobs, they can only be located in peripheral locations, low-density locations. So the peri-urban should be seen as a piece of the whole, and there are more gardeners in Los Angeles than in San Francisco. Well, Los Angeles could be denser, but it should be prepared. But then all judgment that you can have about the benefits of density should take into the fact that for a real estate developer, density is extremely costly. So you should wonder whether the beneficiaries really pay for these services. That's not the case for the Paris region, for instance. Jean-Michel Roux, you were the visionary. You opened this roundtable, and you were the last speaker. You are the last one to speak for this roundtable. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Merci beaucoup. Italien schicken nicht.